Well, good evening, church family. We're glad you're here to worship with us. If you would stand tonight, we're going to sing about a God who is amazing and who has grace for us. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing. Done for me. Amen, church. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice. Shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Sing it out, church. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing. Conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
Another person, I have to call him Dr. Bob Barton now. When I met him, he was Reverend Bobby B., and he's a fireball. He's done a lot of great things for the Lord, and so I wanted him to come tonight because He meets with me about once a month and keeps me in line, straightens me up, tells me all the stuff I do wrong that you guys are afraid to tell me. So he tells me all those things, but he has been faithful minister for many years, and he's been faithful in my life. And so I wanted him to come share. He's a true preacher now, so he kept asking me, how long does he have? And I told him 15 to 20 minutes. So if he goes over that, I told him we got a little trap door up here. Get him over here and we'll just sink him on down. But I want him to come now. He's going to share some from the Word of God and challenge us tonight as well. So y'all welcome him.
Thank you, Ted. Wow, how exciting is this? This is absolutely wonderful. I remember when I first met Ted, and I want you to pay attention to what God is doing in your life, and I want you to pay attention to people that come across your purview when you're just minding your own business and people cross in front of you. Ted and Aaron crossed in front of me. I had served at First Baptist of Jacksonville for 22 years. And the last 2.5 years I was there, I was college and singles pastor. So I kept hearing about this guy named Ted Owens, that he was going in the ministry and he was going to Liberty and getting another degree and preparing for ministry. And so I said, he would be perfect to teach this 20-year-old singles class, a co-ed singles class. And Ted dragged his feet and dragged his, I'm going to go on about this for a while, okay? He dragged his feet, and I finally had to insult the poor guy and said, look, you're going to be a pastor of a church, and you can't even figure out if you can take a 20-year-old singles class? Come on, man. It was like a Joe Biden thing. Come on, man. So, that was really bad. So I said, Ted, you got to do it, man. You've got to do it. And Garrett is my dear friend, too, your brother. And so, anyway, I was paying attention to these young men, as I always have. God has given me a lot of young men over the years to mentor and to speak into their lives. And so I was just so happy that God put Ted in my life, just that short little window of time that I was there. And of course, Aaron was there with him. All the kids were really little, and Danny and Rochelle were there, and then Mom and Dad were there. And all of a sudden, we had this team that was just unbelievable. And they went into that class that had about 20 people in it. Before you knew it, they had about 50 people in there. How long did you teach that class? Yeah, so that's it, man. That's how things like that start. And I would just say, if you're here today, tonight, and you're in this church, and you're wondering about whether you should serve or not, say yes. Say yes to the question. When they ask you, come and serve and do something, then you never know. I could have never imagined that this would happen, that Ted would be a pastor for all these years, and now moving into this great facility, and what an exciting thing it is. And I'm very proud of you. I love you. I'm really thrilled about what God has done in your life and how he continues to work in your life. I want to talk to you just briefly, and he did say 15 minutes. Just now I heard 20 minutes attached to it. I didn't. I don't know. Josh, he was a little bit nervous, I guess. Where's Josh? There's Josh. So Josh was one of those kids too. He's younger than Ted, obviously, but Josh was one of those college kids. Is he younger than you? What did I do wrong? Josh was one of those guys, and the Lord was working in him, and he was part of the college kids. And was he in that class of yours? He didn't come to church back then. Okay. No, he was in the college class. That's where he was. You were in the college. Okay. So we had college, and then we had all these singles classes, 20-year-old co-ed, 30-year-old co-ed, all the way up to senior adults in that ministry back then. But just pay attention to what God is doing, because God is at work in people's lives. He's at work in your lives. And you should pay attention to the Holy Spirit. That's what this is about. I want to talk to you about the Church of Antioch. So do y'all bring your Bible to church? And does Ted have you bring your Bible to church, or your pad, or your, what do you have? You don't even have your own Bible. Somebody bring a Bible to Ted, or give him a smartphone or something. I'm going to read a bunch of scripture, okay? This is a sermon with no point, so it's just a whole bunch of scripture. So I want to talk to you about the Church of Antioch. I told Ted when I had breakfast with him this week, I would call this when God shows up to church. And it is always nice when God shows up to church, right? And God is always pleased to show up when two or more are gathered in my name. He's promised to be there. So let me just tell you briefly, let's just go quickly through these texts. So we're going to start in Acts chapter 11. So if you do have your Bible, it'll be better for you if you have a Bible in front of you, or open up your app there, and let's look at how God was at work in a very surprising way. I would say a lot, Ted, this church and the way it's come about is sort of like the church of Antioch, sort of like these rogue people at work, you know, and these unapproved people, you know, these people that are stepping out by faith, these people that are, they're not part of the big organization. They are like, who are those people? What are they doing? And what's going on down there? That's actually what Antioch was. But Antioch became the first sending church, the first missionary church, the first church that actually intentionally sent out missionaries. Now, this church and every other church can accidentally send people out because they try not to, and then people leave and they go out anyway with the gospel. Or else this church can follow the steps of this pattern from Antioch and watch how the Holy Spirit puts groups of people together, and then this church and every missional church in the world becomes a sending station. It becomes an outpost, a gospel outpost. I would say at the start of this, very short sermon, as you know, for Bob, I just want you to know that I usually preach like a lot longer than that. But anyway, my Sunday school lessons are longer than that. So I don't know what to say. But God will be at work. And the church is supposed to be like a train station, like an airport with people coming and going. Now, whether you acknowledge it or not, it's going to happen. Ted is not always going to be the pastor of this church. Josh is not going to always be the associate pastor of the church. They may be here for many, many years, and we hope they are. But 30 years from now, and 50 years from now, and 100 years from now, if the Lord tarries, this church will have had many, many pastors, a great diversity of pastors. And a lot of people will have come and gone. A lot of people will have been sent through here. And a lot of people will be out at the ends of the earth. I couldn't imagine where Ted would end up down here. And we never know what God will do in the future, but God is actively working in people's lives and sending them on mission and using mission stations like this as gospel outposts where people are joyful and where there's family and when there's community and when there's love, and the people that have come through here will want to come back through here again. And let me just read quickly these texts to tell this story. And let's go ahead and pray. Father, thank you so much for this very special moment. Thank you for my dear friend and these dear friends that are here and all that you've done in the work here at Petra, and calling Ted, ordaining him, calling Josh, ordaining him, using these families in such a marvelous way. Thank you for all who have been saved. These two who will be baptized tonight, what a joyous occasion this is. And this church launching in a new place, a new address, but still the body of Christ together, and the body of Christ multiplying and serving itself and blessing others and being used by your Spirit in a marvelous way. Bless these words to our heart. I pray that these simple truths would be a great encouragement to this body of believers, that they would see themselves for who they are, not for who they are not, but for who they are in the very strategic place that they have been given in the body of Christ for this time. And I pray these things in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. Look at Acts 11, verse 19. Then those who were scattered because of the persecution that occurred in connection with Stephen made their way to Phoenicia and Cyprus and Antioch, speaking the word to no one except Jews alone. But there were some of them, men of Cyprus and Cyrene, unnamed people, by the way, who came to Antioch and began speaking to the Greeks also, preaching the Lord Jesus. This is how this church started. Some unknown people from an island came to the mainland and started preaching to Greeks, and then something amazing happened. Look at verse 21. This is Acts 11, 21. And the hand of the Lord was with them, and a large number who believed turned to the Lord. The news about them reached the ears of the church at Jerusalem, and they sent Barnabas off to Antioch. Verse 23. Then when he arrived and witnessed the grace of God, he rejoiced, began to encourage them all with resolute heart to remain true to the Lord. For he was a good man and full of the Holy Spirit and of faith, and considerable numbers were brought to the Lord. And he left for Tarsus to look for Saul, and when he had found him, he brought him to Antioch. For an entire year they met with the church and taught considerable numbers, and the disciples were first called Christians in Antioch. This is an accidental church. This is a church that should have been started years before, and yet the church in Jerusalem, instead of obeying the commission that Jesus gave the church to go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature, sat because they loved the fellowship. You know how it is in church? You love the brethren. You love being here. And all of us are this way. And yet, if we will obey the Lord, then we will not sit. We will move. We will always be active in sharing Christ and preaching the gospel. Well, because of persecution that happened, these people ran, and then Antioch became the first Christian outpost, the first notable other church. Remember, there's only one church in the world, right? The church at Jerusalem. That was it, one church. This is 10 or 12 years later. Finally, the second church of note is being birthed accidentally with a bunch of rogue people that are unnamed, and all of a sudden you have this fellowship that is dynamic, and God is at work, and the Holy Spirit shows up. Now, let's look at Acts chapter 13, verses 1 through 4, and this shows the birth of this amazing church and why the church at Antioch is a model for mission sending. And I would say that if this church continues in that model, if this church embraces that model and becomes this mission sending church, then God will bless this church immeasurably, and the story of this church will go to the ends of the earth. It will be amazing what God can do from a small nucleus of faithful people. And here's the story. Acts 13, 1 through 4. Now there was at Antioch in the church that was there prophets and teachers, Barnabas and Simeon, who was called Niger, and Lucius of Cyrene and Manaen, who had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch, and Saul. Five preachers, very diverse. Some of them were rich, some of them were poor. At least one of them was black. A bunch of them were Jews. They were Greeks. It was a whole diversity of skill sets and nationalities, and that's actually what the church is supposed to look like. It's supposed to be what the Revelation 7 is, people from every nation under heaven worshiping together. That's what a true church of the Lord Jesus Christ looks like. That's what this one looked like. And remember, Paul had been saved on the road to Damascus. Now 12 years later, and Barnabas has grabbed him out of hiding, if you will, in an obscure place for 7 or 8 years. Nobody knew what he was doing. But Barnabas said, we got to have this guy working in our church. And so you have five pastors, and in that Holy Spirit-infused environment, the Holy Spirit speaks to the church. Now, sometimes the Holy Spirit speaks through the pastor. Sometimes it's among the laity. You never know. But the church together agreed that God was doing something supernatural in its midst. Do you sense that here in this church? That God is at work, something is happening. And when the church agrees that that is what is happening, then the church can move. The church can make plans. And I've said this many times, we have our plans and God has his plans. We don't know how all these plans will turn out, but we're trying and we're working and we are endeavoring to please the Lord. And then God himself shows up. Look what happens at this church in Antioch. And remember, this is Antioch of Syria. It's like 200 or 300 miles north of Jerusalem. It's in modern-day Turkey is where this is. It's not in Syria. It's above Syria in Turkey where this town of Antioch is today or was back then. And so in that Holy Spirit-infused environment, which you always want to sense that God is at work. And when you park your car, that God is here and waiting. And when the people of God gather, then there's a super Holy Spirit-charged environment. Verse 2, while they were ministering to the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them. Then, when they had fasted and prayed and laid their hands on them, they sent them away. Verse 4, so being sent out by the Holy Spirit, they went down to Seleucia, and from there they sailed to Cyprus. This is the first missionary journey. Two of the five pastors were called out It wasn't that they volunteered. Now, obviously, they were willing to go. There's two ways that people can go out to be used of God in a special way or special service for the Lord. One is you can volunteer to do it. But another thing is when God calls you out or when the church says, you're the one, you're the woman, you're the man. We sense God working in you. We want you to do this. I believe as much as anything else, as much as I joked about it, I believe when I met Ted Owens, God was telling me to tell him, you're the man to do this. And sometimes the church does that. And the church ought to be active in doing that because this is one way that God, the Holy Spirit, works through the body of believers. There was great unanimity in the church. The church agreed that God was doing something bigger than their place. God was doing something for the kingdom of God, and these two couldn't be contained there in Antioch, even though all kinds of people were being saved. And it was so remarkable. Barnabas was sent from Jerusalem to say, what is going on down there? We're not even sure they're approved. We're not even sure this is legit. But Barnabas got out there, and he saw what was happening, and he said, it is legit. God is doing something. In fact, I'm going to become a pastor here, and a lot of people are being added to the Lord, and I'm going to get Saul and bring him. And then after a year of ministering, then God shakes it up again and says, these two are going. Aren't you glad they went? We wouldn't be here today if those two hadn't gone. Humanly speaking, if the first missionary sending church hadn't sent the first missionary team, we wouldn't even be here tonight. You can see how God the Holy Spirit works in this kind of environment. So they were sent out for an undisclosed period of time. They didn't know how long they would be. Remember, they didn't have any cell phones, you know. They didn't know where actually they were going. They were just going out to the work. God was going to unfold the work for them as they went. Perhaps they were given some money, but they didn't know how they would be supported. They didn't know how far they would go. They didn't know how long they would be gone. They didn't know when or if they would ever come back. And yet they were willing to go out for the sake of the name, being sent by the Holy Spirit because God was at work and God was doing this and they couldn't deny it. So they sent two of their five pastors out for the first missionary journey. This journey is chronicled in these two chapters, chapters 13 and 14. Now, you know that Paul on this journey was stoned to the point of being dead. In fact, everybody around him thought he was dead. So if everybody around you is looking at you on the road and you've been stoned to death with rocks, they have thrown rocks on your head, and you are laying there and everybody thinks you're dead, most likely you are dead. And he got up and walked back into the city. Most likely God raised him from the dead. That's pretty miraculous, okay? And when he got back from this desperado place at the ends of the earth, it was really dangerous and really crazy. He loved it, and he wanted to go back. But what happened was this missionary church that had sent him was their home base. And turn the page. Look at Acts 14. Look at right at the end of this chapter. And what happens at the end of a mission trip is they came back home. 46 through 48. Paul and Barnabas. Acts 14, 26 through 28. From there, they sailed to Antioch, so they're coming back, from which they had been commended to the grace of God for the work that they had accomplished. When they had arrived and gathered the church together, they began to report all things that God had done with them and how he had opened a door of faith to the Gentiles. This is pretty significant. Paul is saying, here, Jesus, here's the offering. It's the Gentiles. It's all of us. Here, the door of faith to the Gentiles has been opened. Maybe God is working on the heart of some young man or some young woman, even in this room tonight. And God is going to use you to open the door of faith to the Gentiles or a people group or plant a church. Who knows what God might be doing. Verse 28, and they spent a long time with the disciples. They were home. But they couldn't stay home for long because God, the Holy Spirit, was working in them and stirring them up. Turn to 15:30. So when they were sent away, they went down to Antioch, and having gathered the congregation together, they delivered the letter. They had gone up to kind of straighten some things out in Jerusalem at the headquarters with the apostles, verse 31. when they had read this letter, they rejoiced because of the encouragement. Verse 32, Judas and Silas, also being prophets themselves, encouraged and strengthened the brethren with a lengthy message. After they had spent time there, they were sent away from the brethren in peace to those who had sent them out. But it seemed good to Silas to remain there. Verse 35, but Paul and Barnabas stayed in Antioch, teaching and preaching with many others also the word of the Lord. Verse 36, after some days, Paul said to Barnabas, let us return and visit the brethren in every city in which we proclaim the word of the Lord and see how they are. You see how easy that is, how simple that is? It's a desire that God puts in someone's heart to serve. It's a call that's sort of, it's unmistakable, but it's you can't really figure it out. Why does that happen? How does God put desire in a person's heart to start a church or to win a soul or to teach a class or to serve in a ministry? And yet he does. And such a simple thing, he said, let's go. Let's return and visit the brethren in every city in which we proclaim the word of the Lord and see how they are. Verse 37, Barnabas wanted to take John, called Mark, along with them also, but Paul kept insisting that they should not take him along, who had deserted them in Pamphylia and had not gone with him to the work. And there occurred such a sharp disagreement that they separated from one another, and Barnabas took Mark with him and sailed away to Cyprus. But Paul chose Silas and left, being committed by the brethren to the grace of the Lord. He was traveling through Syria and Cilicia, strengthening the churches. Sometimes in God's work, Christians get sideways with one another. Sometimes feelings get hurt. Sometimes people separate from one another. But what happened here was there were actually two missions groups that was formed out of this breach. And then, of course, later, they were reinstated with one another. But for now, there would be two missions trips for the second missionary journey. And then if you would, just turn a few more pages and let's look at the end of this. And let's look at, two more. Acts 18, 22 and 23. They are gone on the second missionary journey. And it says, Acts 18. 22 and 23. When he had landed at Caesarea, he went up and greeted the church and went down to Antioch. So now the second missionary journey, he comes back home. He can't stay away. He can't stay away from his home church. He can't stay away from these people who had laid their hands on him and sent him off. And so he's back again after a number of years, again reporting back to the church in Antioch. And verse 23 says, and having spent some time there, he left and passed successfully through the Galatian region and Phrygia, strengthening all the disciples. And then he goes on the third missionary journey, and we come down to Acts 21:6, and we see, and I'm just speculating here, but it says in 21:6, getting back. He's going back toward Jerusalem. He may not have gone back to Antioch, but the language is here, 21:6. Then we went on board the ship, and they returned home again. I imagine it could have been Antioch. If he passed Antioch, it was simply because he had so much other business to do, and God was directing him. And that's the way it is when we follow God. We don't know. We don't know where it's all going to end, but we know it's all going to be good, don't we? And we know that along the way, we're going to collect a lot of people that we love, that God puts in our hearts. And that's the great thing about serving the Lord. Wherever we land, we find people that are like-minded and people that we perhaps served with before and people that we'll serve with again and people with whom God's Spirit is working. So what was it about this church? Well, it was a multicultural church. It was full of gifted people, as every church is and as this one is. It was a church that was Holy Spirit empowered. I hope you see these things in this church. It was a church that was a sending church. It was a church that was a receiving church. Not only they send people off, but they receive them back. It was a multiplying church. It was the mother church, if you will, to all the other churches in the world in some sense, because it was the church that would be the model for sending missionaries out to the ends of the earth. It was a multiplying church. Well, here we are in this little spot here in God's great kingdom. And I'm glad to have been here tonight and to relay these truths to you. Perhaps God is working in your heart. I don't know if he is. I hope he is. And I hope that whatever the question is, you will say yes. You will say yes to Jesus Christ in this gospel outpost here called Petra Baptist Church. Who knows what God will do as he continues to work here. We're going to pray, and we're going to have an invitation. Why don't we stand? We're going to stand for an invitation. We're going to have a short invitation. Josh, you're going to come sing for us. I'm going to pray, and we're going to have an invitation. Perhaps you want to join this church, or perhaps you want to come say something to Brother Ted that God is at work in your heart, or maybe you want to pray here at the altar for just a minute. But I'm going to pray, and then you respond as the Holy Spirit leads you. Thank you, Father, for your goodness, for this sweet moment among friends who are like-minded, people we love, people whom you love, people whom your Spirit has directed in remarkable ways, people whom we admire. And we're so happy to be here with them tonight, and happy to observe your great work in these hearts. Bless this church in every way. Give Ted a special anointing of your Spirit. Bless Josh as he serves alongside him. Give him a special touch of your Spirit. Use this church. Use it for your glory. Use it for all that you've intended for it to be. And we'll thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Splendor of the King was clothed in majesty, and all the earth rejoiced, all the earth rejoiced. Here wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. And how great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And oh, you'll see how great, how great is our God. Verse with me this evening. And age to age he stays. Time is in his hands. Beginning in the end. Beginning in the end. The God had three. Father, Spirit, and Son, Lion and the Lamb, Lion and the Lamb. Sing this out now. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And all we'll see how great is our God. You're the name above all names. You're so the name above all. is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. Oh, you see how great, how great. How great, how great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God. And oh, you see how great, how great is our God.
All right. Well, to God be all the glory. Amen. Is that right? My dad told me this before, and you guys know a lot of my dad's sayings. If you see a turtle on a fence post, you know he did not get there by himself, right? So you know God has put a lot of people in my life, and Dr. Barton was one of those guys, and I've shared some others all day today, and it's hard sometimes for me to stop, slow down, and really think about all the goodness that God has given to me in my life and how good God really has been for me and obviously for my wife Erin. You guys know she has been my rock. She is the best thing that's ever happened to me other than Jesus Christ. She has been something that has always encouraged me, always loved me, and every time I quit she packs me back up in the car and brings me back up here, and I said, I don't even like the preacher there. She said, you're still going to church. And she's been such a blessing to me in my life. And I would not be here without her, I know, 100%. So I appreciate her. And obviously her mom and dad who's here tonight, Mr. Donnie, Miss Joan, thankful for them to raising a godly woman. And she was a Christian when we got married. And she challenged me in my faith. And you guys did a great job of raising her, pouring the things of God into her. And I really, really appreciate that, and my other family that's here as well. And then obviously my family, my mom and dad have been here for me from the start. I guess they didn't have a choice, but really just always encouraging me. Like I said, I get to work with my dad every day. It's been a blessing in my life, and just to learn from him to grow. And for him to believe in me, and obviously my mom to be the brains of the operation, keeping us in line, keeping us straight, and then my brother. A lot of people ask, how in the world can you do what you do and pastor church when you have a family like mine? It's easy. I have a dad and a brother that I work with every day, and I know times are tough for me sometimes, but they allow me to do this. They understand this is a ministry, not just my ministry, this is a family ministry. That's the way it started. Reverend Barton started with us, me and my brother, serving in a Sunday school class together, and be able to come here into church and be able to serve my family. God has been really, really good to me. And also Rochelle, obviously, Danny's wife, and she's got a lot of blessings coming her way for putting up with Danny for all these years, keeping him straight. It's been good, and God is good. And I said it this morning, I really mean it. The price to serve God is high, but the price of not serving God is higher. And I would rather suffer for doing good and the work of the gospel than to suffer for evil and part of this world. And that's just the way that I look at this. And I'm blessed beyond measure for this church, for every one of you that's invested in my life, poured into my life, poured into my kids' life and my family's life. And so tonight comes one of the greatest times in my life as well. I get to baptize. And you guys know baptism is the first sermon a Christian will ever preach. It's not as you were saved, there's nothing magical about these waters. Both of these young ladies have accepted Jesus Christ in their life. My daughter accepted the Lord on a Lord's Supper, if you can believe that. Sometimes when we observe the Lord's Supper, we don't really understand how powerful of a message that is, but she wanted to know about it. She learned about it, and she gave her heart to Jesus Christ. And then Kaylee, who is my niece, she saw a baptism and went home, asked her mom and dad, and they led her to the Lord to understand what baptism is. And I talked to both of them about this is just a picture of what's happened in their heart already. And they are here tonight to preach a sermon to you that as we baptize them, that is the old man passing away. And when they're raised and to walk in a new spirit of life. And that's what they have come to proclaim tonight. And I get the joy of to be able to do that. And so I ask you to pray with me before we start, and then we'll actually observe the baptismal. So let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father God, we do thank you for Courtney. We thank you for Kaylee. We thank you for their hearts that they've given to you, Lord. And what a blessing it is for them to come to want to preach a sermon to tell others about Jesus. And I encourage you, if you're here tonight, you've never given your heart to Jesus, it's the greatest thing you'll ever do in your life. And just as these girls have come up here to be baptized, that you too can preach a sermon in your life. And when you trust in Jesus Christ and you put your faith in Jesus alone, that you will be saved and your life will be transformed. And all the guilt and all the shame and all the sin will be washed whiter than snow. And Jesus, we thank you for the sacrifice that you paid for my life, for these two girls' lives, for the sins of the whole world. That if we confess with our mouths and believe in our hearts, then we shall be saved. What a promise we have, and what a celebration we can have knowing that salvation belongs to God and he has shared it with us through Jesus Christ. What a great, great testimony. And I pray for us as a church. We will disciple these young ladies. We will pray for these young ladies, and we will see them sent out from this place to be missionaries from this place to be able to go share the gospel wherever they go and however that far they go, that they will always bring you glory and honor with their lives. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. I just pray it's not with me some young boys. All right. So I'm going to ask Courtney and Kaylee if they would come up here. I'm going to ask Rochelle if she wants to come up here, and Aaron as well. And can you guys see all right over there? You good? Come over here on this side, girls. Who's going first, Kaylee? All right, so first up is Kaylee Owens. She's coming to be baptized tonight. She's going to come in. They've been fascinated by this baptistry, by the way. Some of you may wonder where this is. It's always in the back with a table on it. And so we get to break it out and use these things. Are you all right? Okay. So tonight you've come to express your faith and personal trust in Jesus Christ. Have you received Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? You have? Amen. All right, you ready? All right, well, in the power vested in me by the power of the gospel, I now baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit, buried with Christ and raised and walk in the newness of life. Amen. Ready? Come on out. Got it? Now for Courtney Owens. She's coming for baptism tonight. All right. Have you received Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior in your life? You have? Well, amen. Well, tonight I baptize you, my sister and daughter, in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit, buried with Christ in the likeness of his death and raised to walk in the newness of life. Amen. I've had the privilege to be able to baptize all my nephews and nieces except one. Austin was baptized at First Baptist Church of Jacksonville. Dustin was the first person I baptized at church, at Petra Baptist Church. And now being able to baptize my daughter and Miss Kaylee. And one thing my father-in-law told me when I was ordained is, you know, Brother Jason did my ordination, part of the council. He told me, he says, don't try to win the whole world and lose your family. He said, make sure you witness and be a good testimony to your family. And to be able to baptize my three children and know that they've come to know Jesus Christ and my brother's children as well, God is really, really good. And I'm so thankful for that. To see them come to know Jesus Christ. So I'm going to close with a word of prayer. We do have some refreshments and some drinks as well. You can stay as long as you want and hang out and have a time of fellowship. We are really, really excited for you to be here. So let's pray. Dear Father God, what a day. What a day of celebration. What a day of goodness that you've given us and mercy you've shown us, Lord. Thank you for just your calling on my life, Lord. And I pray that I'll be like Joshua. I'll just be faithful, Lord. That I won't be discouraged or dismayed, but Lord, that your calling will be true. And if you have commanded it and you have called us, Lord, I pray we'll be faithful to do that, Lord. Thank you for these girls' testimony and you, Lord. Thank you for these families and homes and each individual in this room and even maybe watching online that's invested in these children, Lord. What a testimony it's going to be one day when we all get to heaven and we really understand how much an impact that just from a simple calling or simple obedience to teaching a Sunday school lesson or being a part of a service where we have the Lord's Supper or a baptismal service, how much eternal impact that really can have in a person's life, Lord. And I pray that we'll look to the things that really matter, eternal things. And God, I pray as a church, as we dedicated this building, this place today, God, that we will never waver. That Jesus is the hero. He will always be the hero. He is the rock. He is Petra. He is the great rock of our foundation, God. And I pray that we will never fail to mention him, to preach him, to live him, to witness to him. And it's all about Jesus Christ and what he's done for us, Lord. What a great, great time of celebration we've had, Lord. I ask you to be with us now as we have this time of refreshments. And I pray that you be this time of fellowship, Lord. I pray you'd be honored and glorified with all that we say and do. In Jesus' name. We all said, amen. All right.